former defense minister and IDF chief of staff, Moshe Bogi Yaalon. Thank you very much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
20 years now day to the second intifada. You remember the date when Ariel Sharon went to Temple Mount and all hell broke loose?
Yes, I do remember, but I don't call it the second intifada. I called it the Palestinian terror war, because from my point of view, it was a deliberate attack, and the Sharon visit to the Temple Mount was an excuse. Actually, I foresee the eruption of the violence on summer 99, when Prime Minister Barak declared that he was intending to conclude the final settlement with Arafat within 15 months. 15 months, it was September 2000. So since July 99, in my command, I was OC of Central Command, I said we have to be ready for a war initiated by
And you
Arafat
prepared
in
the
September.
Forces at the time in your under your command, in the Central
sure.
Command, for such an event?
Sure. And, you know, I felt like, you know, the atmosphere in Israel was Barak was elected to be prime minister. He was talking about peace, intending to go what appeared to be Camp David. That was the atmosphere. Peace is around the corner. And I said we should have been prepared for war, because I understood Arafat trying to avoid any kind of final settlement by giving up the right of return and other elements in his ideology. And I said in order to avoid it, he will initiate a war, which is called by them Al-Aqsa Intifada. That was a deliberate attack, from my point of view, initiated by Arafat.
But what you're saying, if it wasn't Sharon's visit, it would have been something else.
Absolutely. He tried to make it even on July. There was a demolition of a Palestinian building, our building in East Jerusalem, in the Armenian quarter. He tried to ignite the fire at that time, but he failed. At the end, he understood that he should have used the Temple Mount as an excuse, as he used it in 96 as well. And he prepared the Tanzim as an example, led by Marwan Barghouti. I followed it from the Central Command. The Nakba Day of that year, in 2000, May 2000, was unique. We observed shootings from the Tanzim element, snipers, for the first time. I called that day the preparation of the Palestinian people for the coming war, whether it will be September or July, whatever. That was Arafat's idea.
But when he goes there in September, what does he hope to achieve?
Oh, the idea was not to negotiate Barak proposal on Camp David on July 2000, but to use the violence in order to get more concessions from the Israeli side, even a surrender of the Israeli side without giving anything. That was the idea. Now, Barak understood it. Barak said, I'm going to put him on a test, Arafat on a test. I will try it, I will do all my utmost. I will look at every stone in order to get the peace or to fail. If I'll get it, fine. If not, I will expose Arafat's intentions.
And Arafat was exposed.
He was exposed, but unfortunately, in our political situation at that time, in the Barak government, there were those elements who said, oh, it's not a deliberate attack. Arafat is a poor man, he lost control. We should go forward and to give more. That was Taba, which was the end of the story. You know, I remember Muhammad Dahlan saying that we, the Israelis, we are like a lemon, but we can get juice, endless juice from us. That was quite upsetting declaration. So at the end, instead of exposing Arafat, saying he's an enemy, he's not a partner, on September, Barak decided, and he was pushed actually to go to Taba because of his friends in the government, Peres, Beilin, and other, and that was a mistake.
But there were efforts to bring Israel and the Palestinian Authority together, even later, mainly by the Americans. I remember one story, you visiting Paris during conversation with Arafat when he just leaves the American embassy running away by foot.
Yeah, it was quite amazing experience, you know. I put question marks on his Arafat intentions from July 99, even before. But, you know, we tried to conclude any kind of ceasefire. And Secretary of State Madeleine Albright called Arafat and Barak to Paris, to the American ambassador residency. And she tried to get the two sides to declare ceasefire. Actually, we were ready, but Arafat wasn't ready. So it was quite an experience with all the lies of the Palestinian representatives in the room, on top of them, Arafat. But in certain point, we were asked, as the members of the delegation, I was at that time the deputy chief of staff, to get out and to leave Madeleine Albright and Arafat and Barak alone. We heard screaming from the room, and at a certain point, Arafat left the room. He rushed out to his Mercedes outside of the, of the building, trying to get into the gate outside to escape. Madeleine Albright, she ran after him. She ran after the car. She called the Marine Corps guards on the gate to stop him, and they stopped him. She got into his car. She opened the door. She took him out and brought him back to the building. But at the end, in the evening, we concluded the discussions, the negotiations. And he agreed to go back home and to declare ceasefire. But the Americans decided that they should come back, to go back to the Elysee, because President Chirac was hosting the delegations. And Arafat didn't come back from the Elysee back to sign the agreement and to declare it. And on the way back home, it was, I believe, the 4th of October, during the flight, I said it might take now years in order to conclude the conflict, not just because of Arafat behavior, because of the Israeli misunderstanding. There was no readiness to declare that he was an enemy rather than a partner.
And later on, things start piling. He starts releasing terrorists. Israel starts acting much more violently in order to stop terror attacks. And then it piles over and over and makes it impossible to reach any kind of agreement.
That's right, because we were not ready to surrender. And facing an absorbing, devastating attack, at the beginning, executed by the Tanzim. Hamas and Palestinian Islamic Jihad, they were out of the clashes until March 2001. Arafat didn't allow them. He controlled it. But he did encourage Marwan Barghouti to go on with the violence. And at a certain point, you know, we had elections in which Barak was defeated by Sharon. And Sharon came, he understood the situation. We tried to convince him to go, to declare, of course, that Arafat was an enemy rather than partner. He couldn't make it politically at the beginning. Very important terror attack was Dolphinarium, June 2001. Yeah, youngsters celebrating on Friday evening were murdered by suicide bombing attacker. And on the next day, which was Saturday, we had a cabinet meeting in Tel Aviv. And again, there was a discussion whether to declare that Arafat is an enemy or a partner. And there was a compromise. Why? Because Peres didn't agree to declare that he was enemy. Sharon tried to. At the end, it was political compromise. And Joschka Fischer was at that time the German foreign affairs minister. He was quite close to the spot in the Delfinarium because he was hosted in an hotel in Tel Aviv. He tried to negotiate or to moderate any kind of agreement that at that time, Arafat will come out saying publicly in Arabic to his people, seizing the fire.
Enough is enough.
Enough is enough. But at the end of the day, the evening of that specific Saturday, Arafat came out with Miguel Moratinos, the EU representative to the region. And Miguel Moratinos declared in English, seizing the fire. Arafat stood beside and nodded with his head, and that's it. And we had to go on fighting because it wasn't the end of the clashes until Park Hotel.
Until March 2002, and yeah. Then you understood that, okay, everything has to be changed, right?
Yeah, and that immediately after the devastating attack in which we lost many Israelis, and that's months, March 2002, 135 casualties we absorbed in that specific month. And for Sharon, it was enough, it's enough. And that cabinet meeting, even Peres was ready to say that Arafat is enemy, not a partner anymore. So it took us a year and a half, from September 2000 to March 2002. Arafat didn't change anything, but we changed the decision and deciding that he's enemy and not a partner. And then we were ordered, the IDF, to go from the defense to the offense, defensive shield operation, which actually eliminated as a terror infrastructure in Judea and Samaria.
It took quite a few years. I mean, it started yes. when you were deputy chief of staff. It ended during your term as chief of staff. And quite a lot of casualties, efforts, operations.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, but the 9 days of the defensive shield operation, which lasted 9 days, we deployed divisions to get into the densely populated urban area like in Jenin, Nablus, Bethlehem, Tulkarem, and so on. And it was very important because at the beginning we dealt with 180 terrorists in Jenin itself. You know, they were sent to execute terror attacks in Afula, in Hadera, in Netanya, everywhere. So that was the beginning, but it wasn't the end of the terror attacks because there were still terrorists in the region. And I had, as a chief general staff, to go on like dealing with the lawn, to cut weeds again and again and again, and enjoying intelligence dominance, operational flexibility, targeted killing operation, special forces, and so forth. And it took us quite a while, actually, since 2004 till now. We enjoy relatively calm situation security-wise because we went from the defense to the offense.
Prior to that operation, Defensive Shield, Israel frightened itself. What would happen if we get into the centers of the Palestinian city? The casualties, the outcry around the world, it didn't happen.
That's right, but we were not allowed to get into areas A, as we call it, the cities, the Palestinian cities, because of the agreement. According to the Oslo Agreement, it was under the responsibility of the Palestinians, and we were not allowed to get into. But there was no choice at the end because the terrorists were deployed from there. Of course, there was a discussion about how to fight in the densely populated area and what might be the price in casualties. I am experienced in fighting built-up areas, whether it was in Yom Kippur or in Suez, in Beirut in '82, of course, in Litani, 78. This is the most difficult, a formidable challenge for the military. But in that case, I felt like, first of all, we should do it, even with an amount of casualties. But the soldiers, the units on the ground demonstrated professionally.
And that was an answer to those who say that you cannot win against terror. That was a decisive victory against terror.
Absolutely, but it is even more than that. I claim that when we move from the defense to the offense, before shooting the single shot, we change the whole strategic situation, because until then, Israel appeared to be a Zionist entity in withdrawal. Hassan Nasrallah called us a spider web. Ahmadinejad of Iran called us a dry tree. Bashar al-Assad claimed that we will survive for 10 years at that time, not more than that. And that was the perception of the Israeli society, not ready to fight. You know, even our leaders were not sure that we will be able to mobilize the reservists. Before shooting a single shot, the reservists, they asked to fight. They demanded to fight. We mobilized only 28,000 reservists. The entire, the commanders of the brigades, of the battalions, knocked on my door. Why don't you call us? And in the units, there was more than 100% people, personnel coming, 130% personnel, people we didn't call them. And that was quite an important strategic demonstration to say Israel is not a spider web. When it is needed to fight, we are ready to fight, even in the densely populated areas. It is even more than that, because when we witness the Israeli society supporting the military action, who are the Israeli society? The parents of the soldiers, the spouses of the soldiers. It was a very important strategic demonstration.
And what's the outcome? If you look at it 20 years later, what do you make out of it? When we look at Gaza, when we look at Lebanon, we look at the neighborhood, which is changing.
From the very beginning, I said that, first of all, we shouldn't surrender to terror. And we should convince our neighbors, of course, in this case, the Palestinians, but Hezbollah witnessed it, the Iranians and others. We should convince them that we are not going to surrender to terror. And that was an achievement, very important achievement. Of course, by calming the security situation after a couple of years of absorbing homicide bombing attacks, which was unbelievable, calming the situation, we succeeded in managing, equilibrium, in which, in one hand, till now, we use a very big stick against terrorists, whether it is in the north, in Gaza, or in Judea and Samaria, but we do allow the Palestinians who live in Judea and Samaria to live in dignity, to enjoy well-being. This is a carrot, stick and carrot. And that's the way, to my mind, to manage the situation, bearing in mind there is no chance for final settlement to the horizon in one end. On the other end, we don't want to annex them, the Palestinians, the population. And that's the way to manage it.